The studio behind Toy Story, The Incredibles, and Inside Out has a new animated feature based on the fascinating traditions and folklore from south of the border. That is, if you're in the US or Canada, north of the border if you're in South or Central America, overseas if you're anywhere else, except Mexico, which I guess would make you within the border. Okay, look, I should have just said Mexico from the beginning. I regret that now. Pixar's Coco follows Miguel Rivera, a young boy who dreams of becoming a musician like his great-great-grandfather and musical hero, Ernesto de la Cruz. Unfortunately, since Ernesto's disappearance, the Rivera family has placed a ban on all music. But, on Dia de Muertos, the Day of the Dead, Miguel is mysteriously transported to the Land of the Dead, where he seeks the help of his great-great-grandfather and learns the hidden truth of his family's history. But what exactly is the Day of the Dead, or the Land of the Dead? What are those orange flowers everywhere? Who is Ernesto de la Cruz? And why does this dog look so weird? In this video, I will answer all these questions and more, so you don't miss a thing when you see Coco. Or, if you've already seen Coco, I will cover some of the things you might have missed. Or, if you've seen Coco and you didn't miss anything, you're probably Mexican. But just watch the video anyway to confirm that you know all the things that you know. Keep in mind, I will not reveal any spoilers aside from the basic plot that was made clear in the trailers, and will simply give you some context regarding the history, traditions, and references in the movie. Let's get started. Number 1. What is the Day of the Dead and the Land of the Dead? Dia de Muertos, Dia de los Muertos, or the Day of the Dead in Gringo, is an indigenous Mexican holiday practiced mainly in the central and south regions of Mexico. Although as it's grown in popularity over the years, it spread throughout Mexico, the United States, and even the rest of the world. The holiday originates from ancient Aztec religious festivals honoring the dead, as well as similar festivals from other ancient Mesoamericans. While many Dia de Muertos traditions can be traced back to ancient Mesoamerican origins, this does not include the date of the festival. The Aztecs venerated the dead during two festivals, the Small Feast of the Dead and the Great Feast of the Dead, which spanned from July 24th to September 1st. However, after Mexico was colonized, there was an attempt to adapt these festivals into the Christian celebrations of All Saints' Day and All Souls' Day, which ironically have their origins in other pagan festivals, like the ancient Roman Lemuria and the Celtic Samhain. In much of the world, All Saints' Eve, or All Hallows' Eve, eventually became known as Halloween.
Halloween, 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 Halloween.
But in Mexico, a unique mixture of cultural influences eventually resulted in Dia de Muertos, a festival that is celebrated on November 1st and 2nd, during All Saints' Day and All Souls' Day. But to be specific, Dia de Muertos generally refers to November 2nd, while November 1st is sometimes known as Dia de los Inocentes or Dia de los Angelitos, and is dedicated exclusively to the souls of children. The thing that separates Dia de Muertos from most other festivals that venerate the dead is the generally upbeat attitude Mexicans have toward it. It is a celebration of life and life after death. To most Mexicans, death is simply a transition into another kind of life. And therefore, when the dead make their annual journey to the world of the living for one single night, there is much reason to celebrate. But how exactly do the living and the dead celebrate? There are many specific traditions, offerings, and other means of celebration associated exclusively with this festival, and these show up all over the place in Coco. For instance, there are the altars, which serve more as an offering or ofrenda for the deceased rather than a memorial. The altar arrangement varies from region to region, even family to family, but often has three or more tiers. The top tier represents the divine. This is where religious icons and a photo of the loved one or loved ones is placed. Or you can place photos on the middle tier, which represents the loved one's life, and is adorned with their personal items, food, drink, as well as a special bread called pan de muertos. The base tier represents the loved one's connection to the realm of the dead, and is adorned with skeletal figurines like the popular Katrina. The entire altar is typically adorned with candles and incense to help guide the dead to the altar, paper-cut banners called papel picados, decorated sugar candy skulls because life is short and sweet, and of course the traditional flower of the festival, the marigold. It is thought the marigold's pungent odor will help guide the deceased to the altar, and a trail of marigolds is often made from the loved one's grave to the home of their relatives, which explains why the bridges between the land of the living and the dead in Coco are made completely out of marigolds. The loved one's grave is also decorated and adorned with ofrendas, much like the altar, and is thought of as a doorway where the deceased will arrive first. Family members will typically spend time at their loved one's grave, perhaps even holding vigils or celebrating there for an entire night. Other celebrations include wearing makeup and costumes, parades, music, drinking, eating, as well as countless other traditions and celebrations that vary from region to region. Regardless of the region, there is one very iconic and unavoidable image that you will find everywhere on Dia de Muertos: the skull. Masks, effigies, figurines, the papel picados, food, and of course the sugar candy skulls remind festival goers of the deceased as well as the deceased-to-be, meaning everyone. While skulls originate from the bodies of human beings, the calavera or skull iconography originates with the Aztecs and other Mesoamerican tribes. The image of skulls and skeletons were revered by the Aztecs, to whom they represented the close link between life and death. The Aztec gods and goddesses associated with death and the underworld were often depicted with skulls for heads or skeletal bodies. And aside from carving skull sculptures out of stone, the Aztecs had no shortage of the real thing for their religious ceremonies, if you catch my drift. Most modern Mexicans are Catholics and therefore believe in heaven. However, the land of the dead in Coco may be in part influenced by the Aztec underworld called Mictlan, as well as the Catholic concept of purgatory. All Souls Day, the Christian holiday that Dia de Muertos now resides on, is dedicated in part to souls caught in purgatory, the realm where souls are cleansed of lesser sin before entering heaven. But as you can see here, the marigold bridges lead to what look like Aztec temples, which is likely a reference to the festival's ancient pagan origins. The marigold flower's association with the land of the dead originates from Aztec religion, as well as several other staples of Dia de Muertos, like Santa Muerte, the Lady of the Dead, and La Calavera Katrina, a skeletal woman wearing a fashionable early 20th century hat. Both figures are an adaptation of Mictlantecuhtli, the Aztec goddess of death who guards over the bones of the deceased and presides over the festivals of the dead. If you keep your eyes peeled, I'm sure you will see many other Aztec references in Coco.
Let me think about this.
Number 2. Who are the dead celebs? The most iconic deceased Mexican celebrities wouldn't be caught dead missing Dia de Muertos, and of course more than a few show up in Coco. Miguel's great-great-grandpa and musical hero, Ernesto de la Cruz, is a fictional character, but is inspired by the late great Jorge Negrete, a much-beloved Mexican musician, singer, and actor who, like Ernesto, left the world of the living far too soon in 1953. Over 60 years later, Jorge is still regarded as one of Mexico's most legendary performers, and is perhaps most remembered for his iconic rendition of México Lindo y Querido.
México Lindo y Querido.
Another iconic Mexican Miguel encounters on his journey is the artist Frida Kahlo. She and her husband Diego Rivera are two of the best known artists to come out of Mexico. And while Frida didn't gain much recognition during her lifetime, since she has resided in the land of the dead, her magical realist style paintings have exhibited in the top galleries and museums in the world, and influenced countless artists. And what about this proud luchador or Mexican wrestler who shows up in the trailer for Coco? His silver mask is a dead giveaway for El Santo, one of the most iconic wrestlers of Lucha Libre. Born Rodolfo Guzman Huerta, Santo's wrestling career spanned nearly 5 decades, and included many matches against other iconic luchadors like the Blue Demon. El Santo also appeared in over 50 films, in which he was pitted against every classic movie monster from Dracula to Frankenstein's Daughter. Miguel's mischievous sidekick in the Land of the Dead, Hector, is a fictional character like Ernesto de la Cruz, but may be a reference to pre-existing mythology. As La Calavera Katrina originated in Aztec myth, Hector may be a loose adaptation of the Aztec trickster figure Huehuecayotl, who is a coyote spirit much like the coyote trickster spirit from Native American mythology further north. Huehuecayotl was the Aztec's patron of music, song, and of course mischief, all things that Hector seems to enjoy. He was also the patron of uninhibited sexuality, which understandably the movie can't make much reference to. It is a family film.
What?
Number 3. What are those multicolored monsters? The multicolored hybrid animals seen in the trailers for Coco are called alebrijes, and are a reference to a Mexican folk art tradition. In the 1930s, the artisan Pedro Linares fell ill and dreamt of these strange creatures. He used the dream as inspiration for painted papier-mâché sculptures, which he called alebrijes, a word that he had heard in his dream. The sculptures appeared in galleries and marketplaces around Mexico City, and in the 1980s caught the attention of Oaxacan artist Manuel Jimenez, who created a wooden carved and painted version. Oaxacan alebrijes became so popular, they are thought to have significantly boosted the economy of the state. And soon after, these colorful sculptures began popping up in marketplaces all over the country. they are today regarded as a staple of Mexican folk arts and crafts. And all because one guy got sick and had a freaky dream.
It's all part of your freaky dream.
Number 4. What's up with that dog? Dante is a Mexican hairless dog, or Xolo Itzcuintli, a breed that was sacred to the Aztecs and other ancient Mesoamericans, and is likely over 3,500 years old. The Aztecs believed the dogs guarded against evil spirits, and also made for a delicious meal on special occasions. The Xolo also happens to be the national dog of Mexico, but is generally regarded as one of the weirdest looking dogs everywhere else. I think they're cute though. So ugly, they're cute. Well, those are all the traditions, myths, and references in Coco I'm going to cover in this video. There is plenty more I could cover, but I want to finish this video while I'm still in the land of the living. If I missed something you think I should have covered or want me to cover in another video, let me know what it is in the comments below. And let me know what you think of Pixar's Coco. To learn about the mythology and history behind other movies and shows, please click on the link in the upper right-hand corner. And be sure to like and subscribe for more videos like this. Viva México, viva Día de los Muertos, mi español es muy muy malo. Adiós.